Hello, good evening. Welcome back to the pyramids series. I spoke before about the idea, how the idea to build the pyramids came up to the ancient Egyptians and how they improved it step by step until we see the shape of the pyramids as today. And he said in the pyramids, it's not just the Great Pyramids of Giza, the three very popular pyramids. No, Egypt has about 100 pyramids. And if you go south of Egypt, Nubia and Sudan, it's more than 200 pyramids. We spoke in details about the era of building the first Zoser step pyramid, then the Dahshur pyramid by King Sennefru, then the family of Khufu, Khafra, Menkaure, who built the three pyramids of Giza. The question here is if this pyramids in Egypt as this shape, is it also limited to Egypt or the River Nile or other spots of the world? When I searched about the pyramids, I found out it's amazing. Everywhere in the world that they have pyramids, in India, in China, in Indonesia, Cambodia, Latin America, and Nubia, how these pyramids came and built in these spots very far from the Egypt. And what's the clue or link between, or is this one culture reached the other, or in one time impossible to be the same, the people think the same thinking in the world to build this kind of structure in one time. So I will show you today some samples of the pyramids around the world, and we will try to find out, is this related to the main builder of the pyramids in Egypt, or the Egyptian took it from other culture. If you see the pyramids like the in Mexico, very popular pyramids like a sun pyramid, the moon pyramid of Mexico, and Boro, this is in Indonesia, Borobudur temple in Indonesia, Zogurat of the Tepe Sialk, Iran, the King Zoser pyramid in Egypt, and those almost the 2610 before Jesus Christ for the King Zoser, the Iran is 3000 before Christ, the Indonesian pyramid 800 before Christ, and the Mexico is between the 4000 before Christ, 3000 before Christ, and still built until after the Christ. And we have in Iran, the pyramid of Iran, say example, is 1250 before Christ, and the Kashta of Nubia 500 before Christ, Kenchi Mausoleum in China is 210 before Christ. The tomb of the general in China too is 300 before Christ. Brank Temple, Cambodia, about 940 before Christ. And El Castillo, Mexico, 1000 years before Christ. Maya in South America, about 500 before the Christ. And the amazing pyramid of Rome in Italy is to the 12th century before the Christ. This is the pyramid of Italy. They say is Cetius. It's in the center of Rome. And they have two pyramids in Italy. And this is many view of this pyramid in Italy. So we have the magical the pyramid of the Mexico, Shishia in China, and the amazing pyramids underwater in Japan. Yunahuni in Japan is a complete, like a town or city under the water. It was thousands of years before the Christ over the water like an island and then sank under the ocean water. So until now, you call it the water pyramid of Japan. So this is, as you see in brief, pyramids everywhere. And we need to know, is it a tie before these pyramids and the Egyptians? Who built first? Who created this kind of structure? So the architect came from the others to the Egypt, or from Egypt to the others. The theory here, it's hard to prove it, need to make the expedition to go visit those people and see if any ties between them or not. In 1969, the scientist came from Norway, Thor Heyerdahl. He tried to prove if Egyptians can travel from Egypt to the shore of the Latin America, that means the Egyptians, they went there and they mixed it with the culture in the local Native Americans, and they give them the idea about building this kind of pyramids. And if did that, this is about 7,000 kilometers far from the shore across the Atlantic Ocean. So it will be easy to go to Italy just across the Mediterranean Sea, or go south the Red Sea and Indian Ocean to the China, to India, to whatever. So the most hard one, Thor Heyerdahl, the scientist, he's explorer and he's an adventurer. He tried to prove the Egyptian could go there or not. So he make expedition for this. This scientist, he has a history of discovering the relation between the civilizations or the different cultures. So he went one day to the isolated islands in the Pacific Ocean, the Polynesian Islands, is close to Australia, between Australia and New Zealand, south of Fiji Island. And he found there the people very similar to the original people in Latin America. And he found the same animals. They have it the whole in islands, the same animals in Latin America. So he said, is it possible? Thousands of years ago, the South Americans, they traveled and they stayed in these islands and they created the population. So he made his very amazing trip with a boat he manufactured or he constructed, same as he saw in Peru monuments in the walls of temples there, thousand years, is a raft made from wood and use a sail and no any kind of improvement equipments. And he took a team from Peru and he traveled 1947 across the Pacific from the shore of the Peru until he reached the island of the Polynesians, about more than 8,000 kilometers in the very tough wild water of the Pacific Ocean. And it was a very risky, it's a big story. He had a book. This the trip, he named it Kon-Tiki. It was a successful experiment. He did it. He said, once we can travel with the raft from the Peru or from the Latin America to these islands, that means those people, they sailed and they reached these islands and they sit there, and the same, the genetic, the people are Polynesian islands close to the New Zealand, and Latin America, same are people. So he came 1969 to Egypt to find out if Egyptian people traveled before thousands of years before Christopher Columbus and reached this kind of land. So it was amazing. He said, okay, he went to the pyramids of Giza. He found the ships, and they call it the sun ships, sun boats, beside the Khufu pyramid of Giza. And he decided to manufacture or construct this kind boat and sail from Africa to America. So he went to Chad and Ethiopia to found the materials to manufacture this, because this was made from the papyrus reed, papyrus stem. This papyrus is amazing. It's a very solid and interior part is spongy. When you put this sticks through to the water, it floats, never sink. So all the pharaohs or ancient Egyptians make their boats from the papyrus sticks. So we will see a biography about this trip. I will just give you introduction how he tried. He went to Chad, went to Ethiopia, and he found out how to collect his materials and started to do this one. So let's go to see in details in this documentary what Thor Heyerdahl did in this, until he sailed and shipped this boat to Morocco and started his trip across the Atlantic. Enjoy the documentary.
Seven men sail from Africa to America in a boat made of papyrus reeds. Men determined to discover whether it is possible that ancient people, people at the dawn of history, sailed across oceans in handmade reed boats and spread their civilization to other continents and islands of the sea. Preposterous, the experts say. Ocean waves will break their boat to pieces. The salt water will dissolve the papyrus. But the possibility haunts the famous builder of the raft, Kon-Tiki. And so he, Thor Heyerdahl, builds a papyrus boat himself, and he calls it Ra. Why does Heyerdahl find this challenge so fascinating? The key to that question is carved on the chest of an ancient stone statue on Easter Island, far off the west coast of South America. A reed boat on an island where once no reeds grew, but because they grow from pieces of root and not from wind-blown seeds, had to be brought there from America by men. Brought how? In what sort of boats? Other things had been brought by ocean-going men to Easter Island and other islands nearby. Pyramids, now reduced to these temple platforms, and once great step-shaped monuments dedicated to the worship of the sun, Ra. Architecture, stones accurately carved and fitted together. Reed boats, still sailing like ghosts in paintings on temple walls, and in these models, with one or more sails carved long ago in stone. The older natives of Easter Island still know the art of making boats of reeds. They use the totora reed, a characteristic South American variety. The ancestors of these natives brought the reed with them from America and planted it in the fresh water of Easter Island's crater lakes. The natives build two kinds of boats, one for swimming near the shore, a float, in the shape of an elephant tusk. But in Peru, ancient people not only made rafts of balsa logs, they also constructed huge reed boats capable of carrying tons of cargo. On Lake Titicaca, high in the Andes Mountains, Heyerdahl found Peruvians making reed boats with sails supported by a remarkable double mast, lashed together at the top. Shortly after the year 1500, when the Spanish conquistadors arrived, they found large reed boats with 12-man crews at sea off the coast of Peru. 1,000 years before Columbus, the South American Indians made pottery models of reed boats which they buried near the coast in the graves of their mummified dead. A A man with a bird's head was often depicted together with the reed boats exactly as had been the practice in ancient Egypt, and remarkably, on Easter Island, too. Ancient Peruvian pictures show the birdman intimately associated with the reed boat. The oldest reed boat builders in Peru and Bolivia left behind large numbers of giant statues, as well as temple walls of huge blocks fitted together like those on Easter Island. When Europeans arrived, they found stepped pyramids like those in the islands of Polynesia, and from the summit, the Indians of Peru worshipped the sun. Their pyramid of the sun is the largest still preserved in Peru. It and the Cerro Colorado pyramid on the coast further north are temple pyramids built as in ancient Mesopotamia with millions of sun-dried bricks. Pyramids in Peru and Polynesia and 1,000 miles to the north on the plains of Mexico too. And in each place, dedicated to a worship intimately connected with the sun. Even more remarkably, pyramid building began suddenly in both Peru and Mexico, and at the same moment of history. Reed boats in ancient Mexico, too. European explorers found them all along the coast from Peru to San Francisco Bay in California and in various parts of Mexico. The last people to use reed boats in this area are the remote Seris Indians on the coast of the Sonora Desert, where Heyerdahl was able to catch them putting out to sea after turtles. Architecture, reed boats, and religion, similar to those of Peru and the islands, were not only here in Mexico, but also in ancient Egypt. Many experts held that these similarities, like the sun-oriented worship evidenced on the back of these gigantic statues in Mexico, were not due to ancient contact from the Old World. Though on their theory, the different climates and environments should have produced different cultures, the experts were able to insist that the similarities were only coincidental, by pointing out that Mexico's pyramids have no burial chambers as Egypt's have. But in 1949, a secret passageway was discovered leading down into the interior of the Mexican pyramid at Palenque. The experts, including Heyerdahl himself, were amazed. For here, in the dense jungle, where there is a superabundance of timber but little stone, the jungle Indians had constructed a stone pyramid with an inner tunnel according to precisely the same methods employed by the ancient Egyptians. A heavy stone doorway led into a burial chamber over which the entire pyramid had been built. A magnificent stone lid weighing several tons covered a sarcophagus. A splendid mask covered the face of the remains of the Sun King's mummy, the flesh long since rotted away by the action of the jungle's humidity. But some people still argued that Egyptian pyramids are not step-shaped like Mexican, Peruvian, and Polynesian ones. But here again, similarities prevail. There are step-shaped pyramids in Egypt alongside the other kind.
In the Republic of Chad lies the little desert village of Bol on the southernmost border of the Sahara. No road leads here to Bol, only caravan tracks through the desert. Here, the Aboriginal culture has remained unchanged for thousands of years, and it would live on independent if our own entire civilization were to be destroyed. I came to Bol because here the papyrus boat of ancient times was still in use, and I had something to learn from the experienced boat builders of the Buduma tribe. Here I met Omar and Abdullah for the first time.
The village of Bol lies on Lake Chad, a large inland sea. Here the Baduma people live on floating islands of vegetation. After they have been to market in Bol, they swim home with their shopping on reed bundles. While other tribes make dugout canoes of tree trunks, the Baduma continue to use their forefathers' boats, made from bound together papyrus, a reed which grows abundantly around the lake shores. The Baduma are pleased to show Heyerdahl how they build their craft. They begin at the bow end, using a single reed split into four parts. They insert other reeds into the middle and bind the ends together with rope. They fatten the bow by constantly inserting new reeds. Fibers scraped clean from palm leaves are braided into durable ropes. Gradually, the bundle thickens and begins to look like a boat, its bow curved upward. The bow is finished off in an elegant tip. But not so the stern. That is chopped off straight just like the coastwise boats of ancient Nineveh. For this craft will never be launched on the high seas, only on Lake Chad. 12 tons of dry and inflammable papyrus reeds are shipped from the shores of Lake Tanna through the troubled war zone at the Suez to Cairo in the Nile Valley. The papyrus reed is a soft flower stem, spongy on the inside. A child can crush it in his hand. Dry, it snaps like a matchstick and burns like paper. But wet, with its thin, watertight skin, it becomes flexible and extraordinarily tough. Only the cut ends will absorb water.
Abdullah, Omar, and Musa seem most pleased with the material. But when I showed them the building site, they asked me where the lake was in which to soak all the papyrus. It had first to be dried in the sun so as not to rot, but then it had to be soaked so as not to break. I had to start hauling water out into the desert in drums. Björn Landström, the leading expert on prehistoric Egyptian boat types, got to see real papyrus for the first time and how light it was in the water.
The papyrus has to be soaked, so a water tank is improvised. But the reeds float so well, it costs three men great difficulty and time just to submerge a single bundle. And Heyerdahl has shipped in 500 bundles. On the basis of many years' study in museums and burial chambers, Bjorn Landström draws the plans for the boat. Like all the other experts, he is certain from the start that a papyrus boat will sink after a couple of weeks. Nevertheless, Landström is keen to see the boat built, if only to test its sailing qualities. The three shipwrights from Chad used the techniques they employed at home. At the same time, simple and sophisticated, their method is to squeeze the porous ends of the papyrus together to make them watertight, and to keep them so by wedging the reeds in under one another like a seabird's feathers. Each bundle is then bound firm with rope. Many bundles are afterwards lashed together. They tie only three large bundles when they are battered by a sandstorm from the Sahara. The sand-filled wind stabs against the tents, ripping away the lighter reeds from the unfinished stern and drying up the papyrus that has been so laboriously soaked. The boat is in danger of becoming airborne before it ever reaches the sea. They act quickly to protect what they have made from blowing away. After 3 days of storm, the papyrus reeds are so dry and brittle they break at the touch, a disturbing state of affairs for material that is meant to carry 7 men across an ocean. The reeds must be watered once again, this time from hand-carried jars, before the work can resume. So far, the boat has been lying on its side. The workers roll it upright.
So far, everything had gone according to plan, exactly as at home in Chad, and strictly according to the ancient illustrations in the burial chambers around us. But our boat builders from Chad wanted to slice off the stern just the way they did at home. They said that no boat had bows at both ends. All my attempts at getting them to build a raised stern in the manner of the ancient Egyptians were utterly fruitless. I also called on Egypt's foremost expert on ancient boat types, Ahmed Joseph, who was in the process of reconstructing Pharaoh Cheops' wooden ship at the foot of the Great Pyramid, but neither he nor Landström were able to persuade Abdullah. Our two academicians tried to teach our friends from Chad how the stern should be built, but Abdullah insisted that one could begin a papyrus reed forward and add more and more toward the rear, but one could not thin them out again so as to make them come to a point at the stern. After 2 days of discussion and a gift of a watch to each of them, our friends finally allowed themselves to be persuaded. Landström was completely exhausted when our boat builders finally agreed to try to make a boat that curved upward to a point in the stern as well.
Through lack of experience, the shipwrights provide a pitifully weak and thin rear end for an ocean-going ship. Supervised by the two learned consultants, the boat nevertheless receives the shape of its ancient prototypes. And Abdullah must not only curve the bow and stern upward to withstand the waves, but in order to match the ancient design, and for reasons unknown to Abdullah and Heyerdahl, he must also curve it inward like a scorpion's tail. The boat completed, it is ready to be hauled from the sands of the desert to the nearest road.
Thank you. These are not slaves who are pulling Ra in the biblical way, but 500 enthusiastic physical education students who are anxious to lend a hand. The papyrus boat moves from the shadows of the pyramids, first pulled by chanting Egyptians, then carried on a truck to the Egyptian port of Alexandria, and at last borne by ship to the ancient Phoenician port of Safi on the Atlantic coast of Morocco.
Here, the reed boat was to enter water for the first time. Would it list? Would it capsize? Many expected it to sink, for according to some papyrus experts, seawater dissolved papyrus. Or papyrus boat had been baptized Ra. Ra was the name of the sun on all the islands of Polynesia, and it was also the name of the sun and the sun god himself in ancient Egypt.
For the very first time, the crew of Ra meet each other. Norman Baker, America, engineer, naval commander, ship's navigator. Carlo Mori, Italy, mountaineer, the cameraman. Planes and boats follow for a few hours. Then they are alone on the Atlantic, swept by strong currents southward along the Moroccan coasts. The trade winds fill the sail. If only the reed bundles will continue to float, if only they will hold together, the west winds and currents will carry them to America. Sinbad the duck, intended for the cooking pot, but never eaten. Her playmate Safi, a parting gift. At the outset, the first of a series of troubles. The one professional seaman aboard, Baker, falls ill with fever. All the rest are landlubbers, including Safi, who's more interested in the provisions than the condition of the boat. Then, the first day out, more serious trouble. The rudders, both of them, snap under the force of the waves. Without rudders, they drift and wallow helplessly in hazardous waters off the rocky coast of the Sahara. In an effort to keep the stern in the wind, they lower their oars in makeshift fashion into the place of the rudders. But then more trouble strikes. The yardarm breaks and the sail has to come down.
Carlo tried to raise the sunken aft section with a whole jungle of ropes, but everything was in vain. The stately but rigid wooden ships of the pharaohs would have broken up in the waves and sunk. Their idea with papyrus boats, however, was that the flexibility would allow them to bend with larger waves. While the forward and middle sections were securely held up by the mast by means of numerous stays, The aft section would flex up and down by itself, held up by a stay of its own running down from the curved stern, which acted as a large spring. But today, no one knew this, and since we lacked that rope, even though the stern retained its beautiful curve, the aft section sank slowly but surely. Too late, we had made an important discovery.
Situation is serious. Suryal can take his mind off it momentarily while he puts the children to bed. But then the crew must hold an urgent strategy meeting. It seems to them that if they don't do something quickly, they will sink. They decide upon a desperate course of action in spite of the danger involved. They will cut up their only remaining life raft, a foam rubber one, and use the pieces to bring up the sunken aft section. Abdullah says his prayers. The rest bed down wondering whether they will be afloat in the morning. Morning arrives, no further sinking. Better they all feel to cling to large papyrus bundles in case of disaster than to venture out in the little foam rubber raft. They begin cutting it up and building up the after section. A far cry from papyrus. The waves break it up and wash it out to sea. Everything follows the undulations of the papyrus, so wooden structures break or are ground into sawdust. Many jars have holes worn into them, or they break. Rudder oars are spliced and spatchcocked from end to end, but not a single papyrus reed is damaged, for the wooden parts break constantly. The cross log holding the rudder oars is sunk so deep, it slows the boat down and has to be sawn off.
We had been sailing for nearly 2 months, had experienced the Atlantic in both storm and fair weather, and were now accustomed to living on a listing boat whose aft section lay underwater. Then we arrived in the area where the American hurricanes at that very moment were developing. And here, with a week sailing to the West Indies still before us, we sailed into the worst storm we had ever encountered.
After the storm, Ra is no longer herself. The sail is down. Everything in chaos. Half the boat is underwater. surrounded by small pieces of papyrus torn from the starboard side where ropes had been chewed off in the storm. Sharks swim among the papyrus.
We kept losing more and more of the papyrus that was supposed to keep us afloat, and the starboard mast lost its support, so we had to take down the sail. The situation was critical.
After a turbulent 3 days of thrashing about in the 20-foot waves of a storm and desperately trying in the storm to make contact with the Shenandoah, the crew of Ra joyfully sight the little yacht.
Everyone was firmly determined to continue. There was only 1 week's sailing more if we rigged up a small sail on the bundles that were still undamaged. But I was the one responsible, and the experiment was not worth the risk of human lives. 2 days later, I decided to let the remains of Ra drift on alone, and we moved over to the Shenandoah.
Their first thought, as they move over to the Shenandoah, is to salvage the film equipment and everything that cannot withstand water. Before they abandon Ra, they cut down their heavy mast and take off everything that can be salvaged.
Onto the deck of the Shenandoah was landed plenty of food and water from the Ra. Before the seven of us, with our monkey and our duck, had transferred over, we had hoisted a makeshift sail on the papyrus boat. It was sad to abandon the Ra so close to our goal. Despite all our beginner's mistakes, Ra was still afloat after 2 months, not just for 2 weeks. A lasting friendship had arisen during the 8 weeks aboard the papyrus bundles, but none of us dreamed that within 10 months we would be sailing together again on Ra 2. Ra 1 continued alone toward America.
Very sad, really very sad, to end the trip like this way, just 1 week away from the Barbados Island in the Caribbean. Very, very, very disappointment. How much effort and work did Thor Heyerdahl and his team to collect the materials, to manufacture this boat, to ship it to Morocco, then you sail for a couple months. How many storms, how many difficulties they faced. They did love work, but unfortunate, it didn't go to the end. So the people, they said, oh, that means the ancient Egyptians never traveled because we are here, we tried, we did the same as they did, but we couldn't contact, we couldn't reach the shore of the Latin America. So is this end of the story? That means no connection? So it's still the question there. How the pyramids came in this, same as the Egyptian pyramids in Mexico? Who give to another? We have to prove it. So it was, we have to investigate. Thor Heyerdahl, he found out it's a design of this boat. It has a default happened. This is a papyrus. The boat was very long, more than it should be. As he said in the, he saw in the pyramids of Khufu, the sun boats was shorter a little bit, because what happened, the to construct this kind of boat, they put group of this papyrus stem together and take it and tie the end, and it's curved to the up. If lift it like this, it's for free. when they sailed for long time, they started the papyrus to curve it down, to concave, so the end of the boat, step by step, became under the level of the ocean. So this is making the boat will sink, because it's not straight enough, as it didn't keep the shape as the boat. So it was a manufacturer design, has defect. So he said, no, I will not give up. I will try again. So he went again, and he manufactured another one, but more stronger, more accurate. And he took exactly from the Khufu sun boats and pyramids, exactly the measure, and he manufactured the other one. This time he manufactured his boat in Morocco, not in Egypt. They said no need to make it in Egypt anymore, and the ship, it was very hard job. It's not easy. So he manufactured and he formed his team again, and he starts another trip. We would see for next part the trip of the reaching the Caribbean island of Barbados and prove the Egyptian can go sailing across the Atlantic 7,000 kilometers to reach and to mix their culture with the native people in Latin America and teach them how to make the pyramid. We will see for next part in details what happened for the second trip. Thank you very much. See you for the next part. Hello, welcome back to the last part of the pyramid story. We stopped at the other part, at the Thor Heyerdahl boat expedition failed just 1 week before reaching the Barbados island of the Caribbean. And he decided to reconstruct another one, more accurate. And he, for that, went to the South America. And he saw the people make the boats similar to the Egyptian or the old Egyptian people. So he hired or employed two people from the Indians or from the Native Americans. And he came to Morocco, Fi Sofia, the try to make another boat. He got his materials from Chad. And he started to build a new Ra. It's called Ra 2. Ra 1 is failed. So we go for the trip for Ra 2. We'll see how Thor Heyerdahl, the scientist from Norway, successfully reached the land of Latin America.
The Indians from Lake Titicaca.
Welcome back. As we saw a big trip with adventurer Thor Heyerdahl, he could use this papyrus reed boat and his with amazing team, and he always make some fun in his trip, like a monkey, a duck, it give some amusement in the trip. We saw how difficult it was. It's not easy to sail across the Atlantic Ocean. But you know, the ancient Egyptians, they were very brilliant in astronomy sciences. So it was easy for them to know directions of the new land and how. I wouldn't know have answer questions exactly about lots of stuff they did it for their when they instruct any kind of museums, pyramids, temples, always they use sciences. So once the boat touched the land of Latin America, that means ancient Egyptians went there. We can say the Mexican came to Africa, and we see the pyramids of Egypt are very progressive and very shapeable, and everywhere. It's not just one or two. In Mexico, very limited. That means the Egyptians went there and mixed it with those people. As we prove in this trip, Egyptian can reach this far land, that means they went to Europe or the Roman people came to Nubia and they got the idea from the pyramids. Pyramids came from Egypt. No any source of that. So the pyramid in Italy, in Rome, came, whatever, Roman came to the, because very close, just across the Mediterranean, came to the Nubia and Egypt and got the idea of this instruction. Or the Egyptian went there. About the Japan and China and India is much and much easier to reach this land comparing with the Latin America, because it's very close and they have land. They can make it with the land, not necessarily with the ocean or the sea. Even that, they know how to reach any land with their papyrus reed boats or whatever, they with their walking or ride their animals. They reach it. So all the pyramids in the world has one source. The one culture came from the old civilization of Egypt. This is a story about the pyramids in brief. We make it in parts to make it short for you. But we listen to the story like something is not normal. It's oddity and wonders to found this kind of huge rocks. Structures made by man-made in a time which was no any equipment, no any kind of cranes, no any hydraulic machines, all man-made with hands and very simple tools. Thank you very much, and we will meet for another amazing story in oddity and wonders. Thank you. Enjoy. Thank you.